So good morning, everyone. I hope you're hearing me loud and clear. Good morning to our faculty and staff, and I hope you had a relaxing Christmas break. And good day to my fellow students as well. I hope everyone's recharged and ready for this new year. So welcome to our first chapel service, not just for the month of January, but also for the year 2023. Can you believe that? It's already 2023. And we praise God for this wonderful time that we have, that we could show to our Father our reliance and dependence on Him as we tackle this new year. Our faith may be even more tested, but the kind of relationship we have with Him will be even more revealed. And so I hope that our chapel service today will be instrumental for our growth in knowledge of our dear Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So I understand that we have lots of things to do, maybe papers to write, documents to accomplish, people to meet, or maybe resolutions to consider. But the more we have in our hands, the more we need to spend more time with God. Thus, we praise God that we have this privilege to study His Word together and an opportunity for us to plead to Him, to be reminded that this is everything that we have is all by God's grace and all for His glory. So before we start, let me remind everyone to keep your microphones muted all throughout the service. You can greet each other maybe after our chapel service. And if your camera's on, please refrain from any unnecessary movements as it may distract our speaker and also others who are here with us. So let's open with a word of prayer to begin our chapel service. Let's pray. Our gracious and loving Father, we are thankful that we can be nourished by your word. Your word is always free and available. It reminds us how glorious and beautiful you are and how privileged we are to be reminded of what truly is significant in this life and even after. We humbly come before you, knowing that it is only by your grace that we can all come together and study your word. Thank you for your goodness and grace to grant us wisdom in order to understand your word, to understand your revelation, to help us put into practice your laws for your glory alone. Father, guide our chapel speaker as well. Grant him wisdom that he needs in order to share your word, to declare only your truth, and to glorify your name. We ask this in the name of Christ. Amen and amen. Now, before I introduce or before we meet our chapel speaker, let us all sing the hymn. Let us all sing the hymn with a story to tell to the nations.
Leave a story to tell to the nations that shall turn their hearts to the right. A story of truth and sweetness, a story of peace and light, a story of peace and light. For the darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning to noon. Song to the nations that shall lift their hearts to the Lord, a song that shall conquer evil and shatter the spear and sword, and shatter the spear and sword. For the darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning to noonday bright. give to the nations, that the Lord who reigneth above hath sent us the Son to save us and show us that God is love. And show us that God is love. For the darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning to noonday bright. And Christ's great kingdom shall come on earth, the kingdom of love and light. Need a Savior to show to the nations who the path of sorrow has trod, that all of the world's great people might come to the truth of God, might come to the truth of God. For the darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning to noonday bright. And Christ's great kingdom shall come on earth, the kingdom of love and light.
Amen, amen. Praise God for that wonderful hymn. Now, our guest speaker is requesting for everyone to please open their cameras. Well, just before he speaks, just for a little bit. So could everyone please open their cameras so that we can see each other? Again, Happy New Year, everyone. Now let's proceed to our scripture reading. I'll read from Daniel chapter 6, verses 1 to 10, and Daniel chapter 12, verses 1 to 3. Let me repeat that. Daniel chapter 6, verses 1 to 10, and Daniel chapter 12, verses 1 to 3. I'll be reading from the English Standard Version. Daniel chapter 6, verses 1 to 10. It pleased Darius to set over the kingdom 120 satraps to be throughout the whole kingdom, and over them three high officials, of whom Daniel was one, to whom these satraps should give account, so that the king might suffer no loss. Then this Daniel became distinguished above all the other high officials and satraps, because an excellent spirit was in him, and the king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. Then the high officials and the satraps sought to find a ground for complaint against Daniel with regard to the kingdom, but they could find no ground for complaint or any fault, because he was faithful, and no error or fault was found in him. Then this man said, "We shall not find any ground for complaint against this Daniel unless we find it in connection with the law of his God." Then the high officials and satraps came by agreement to the king and said to him, "O King Darius, live forever. All the high officials of the kingdom, the prefects and the satraps, the counselors and the governors are agreed that the king should establish an ordinance and enforce an injunction, that whoever makes petition to any god or man for 30 days, except to you, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions. Now, O king, establish the injunction and sign the document so that it cannot be changed, according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which cannot be revoked." Therefore, King Darius signed the document and injunction. When Daniel knew that the document had been signed, he went to his house, where he had windows in his upper chamber open toward Jerusalem. He got down on his knees three times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God, as he had done previously. Daniel chapter 12, verses 1 to 3. "At that time shall arise Michael, the great prince who has charge of your people. And there shall be a time of trouble such as never has been since there was a nation till that time. But at the time your people shall be delivered, everyone whose name shall be found written in the book, and many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the sky above, and those who turn away turn many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. Praise God for the reading of His word. Now let me introduce our speaker for today, but he has a unique introduction through a video presentation. So this is for us to know him a little bit more, but let us watch this video introduction so that before Reverend Wilson Gonzales speaks. Let's watch this. There you go. Let's all welcome Reverend Dr. Wilson Gonzales.
Okay, thank you, Pastor Peter, for introducing me. Good morning, everyone. Peace to be to all of you. So glad to be invited in this first chapel period of the new year. So first of all, my wife Marisa, my family would like to greet all of you a happy, blessed, and prosperous New Year. 祝大家新年快乐，祝大家新年快乐，祝大家新年快乐。哦，language在哪？ Okay. So in this New Year, I would like us to begin the year right by living a life really wise in the eyes of God. As the word of God, Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15 to 16 says, be very careful on how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, for the days are evil. So my message for today is be wise in God's eyes. A month ago, Pastor Peter has already read Daniel chapter 6, verse 1 to 10 and 12, 1 to 3. We are going to look on this passage later on. What if one day you are being kidnapped by the ISIS terrorists, and then they dress you in orange and put you in front of the victim, and then the man in black, that ISIS terrorist, hold a razor sharp knife and put it over your throat and said, if you renounce Christ in front of this coming, in front of the world, then I'll release you, I'll set you free. But if you will remain and said that you will want to be or stays to be faithful to Christ and remain a Christian, then I'll cut your head off. So I want to ask you, if you are the one in front of the camera, of the video camera, what are you going to do or say to the world and to that ISIS terrorist? Of course, for the worldly people or for the secular people, they will say, I renounce Christ. Oh, I want to go free. I don't want to die. But to be wise, not in the eyes of the world, but to be wise in the eyes of God, the best thing to do in front of the world and in front of the camera and in front of these terrorists is to say that you love Christ more than your life, no matter what's the cost. With that, remaining faithful to the Lord Jesus Christ, the whole world will see your good testimony and might be even your martyrdom. Today, many Muslims, Buddhists, Hindus, communists come to know the Lord. It's because of the good testimony and even the martyrdom of the Christians. Third is the fastest growing church in the world now. Is it Korea? No. Is it United States? No. Is it the Philippines? No. The fastest growing church today is in Muslim countries like Iran, like UAE, like Saudi Arabia and Qatar. The fastest growing church are in Hindu countries like Nepal. Many years ago, Nepal only has 15 Christian families. But today, there are more than 1.5 million Christians. And India, wow, very fast in growth. In through CCF alone, the our Beyond Mission, we have helped in India, especially the Ganges River area, establish more than 29,000 house churches and small groups. And so CCF, but there are so many different kinds of parachurch churches who are really working there in India. And the fastest growing churches today are also in Buddhist countries like Mongolia, like Cambodia, and even communist or atheist countries like China. So we can see that God is really at work. And in our story today, in Daniel chapter 6, we can see that Daniel also, he was made to choose renounce the true God, pray to the king as God, and live. Or be committed to the true God, pray to the true God, and be thrown to the lion's den. But Daniel chose to worship and pray to the true God, even at the risk of being seen by his detractors. You can see below there, his detractors. They are looking, what will Daniel do? He is praying to his God. So, Daniel, even after knowing that the decree of the king was made, he continued to pray. That's why in Daniel chapter 6, verse 10, the word of God says, when Daniel learned that the decree has been published, he went to his upstairs room where the windows opened toward Jerusalem. Three times a day, he got down on his knees and prayed, giving thanks to his God as he had done before. So we can see that Daniel, he's not afraid of being thrown to the lion's den. He even opened up his window. He can close his window and then pray secretly. But no, as he has done before, he opened the window, prayed toward Jerusalem, prayed for the remnants there in Israel, prayed for the people, prayed for the kingdom. And three times a day, he got down and he says he really spent time to pray. So in this new year, I want to challenge all of you to really have more time to be intimate with God, more time to pray, even as you travel, as you walk around, as you're doing things, always have that prayer attitude and pray for others and spend time in your quiet time to pray. This is my challenge for you in this new year. But we can see that in verse 11 to 15, the people, when they saw that Daniel is praying as usual, what did they do? Let's see verse 11. Then this man went as a group and found Daniel praying and asking God for help. So they went to the king and spoke to him about the royal decree. Did you publish a decree that during the next 30 days, anyone who prays to any god or except or man except to you, O king, would be thrown into the lands then? Yes, the decree stands in accordance with the law of the Medes and Persians, which cannot be repealed. Then they said to the king, Daniel, who is one of the exiles from Judah, pays no attention to you, O king, or to the decree you put in writing. He still prays three times a day. When the king heard this, he was greatly distressed. He was determined to rescue Daniel and made every effort until sundown to save him. Then the man went as a group to the king and said to him, remember, O king, that according to the law of Medes and Persians, no decree or edict that the king issued can be changed. So what did the king do? The king gave the order and they brought Daniel. Okay, post muna tayo dito. Let's stop here. Because something still happens before the king sent the soldiers through him to the lion's den. I believe that when Daniel was in front of the king gave him a chance. Daniel, now, is it true that they accuse you that you do not pray to me, the king? You only pray to your God? Show me now to those people and to these people that you pray to me. And the king, I believe he loved Daniel. He respected Daniel. He wanted to save Daniel. He don't want Daniel to be thrown to the lion's den. So he might say, in his eyes, he will wink and say, or in that, in Tagalog, say, you can pretend to pray to me. It's okay. Just pray. But Daniel, he stood firm. He said, I will only pray to the true. This is in front of the people. If you even pretend, the people will, you do not pray to the true God now. You pray to the king. You fall into the trap. So because Daniel remained faithful and stand firm to his conviction, so the king threw him to the lion's den. Of course, sending the soldiers to throw him, but the king went along so that he was thrown into the lion's den. But here, what did the king say? May your God. So the king know the Daniel. The frame up, the king was framed up by those accusers, those satraps and those officials. But the king say, may your God, whom you serve, continue, will serve, that will rescue you. So Daniel, the king know that Daniel will continue to serve the true God, and God will rescue Daniel. So in Daniel chapter 12, verse 3, we can see that the word of God says, those who are wise, like Daniel is really wise in the eyes of God. For the people, since he's wise, he's thrown to the lion's den. But those who are wise will shine like the brightness of the heavens. And those who lead many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. The context of this Daniel chapter 12 is about the last days during the resurrection of the righteous. These are the people who are raptured and then resurrected. And also those who die during the tribulation days are resurrected. They are those people who are going to enter the millennial kingdom. So the wise, who are the wise? Those lead many to righteousness. They will shine brightly, the brightness of the heaven as the stars forever and ever. So who are those people who lead many to righteousness? Who lead people to worship the true God? Who leads people to Jesus Christ? Because Jesus Christ is the source of righteousness. So these people who lead people to the Lord Jesus Christ to worship the true God, they will shine brightly. So this morning, I would like to ask you, how bright will be your light during the time of the resurrection when you're in front of Christ? Or during the time we, those resurrected, will be honored, praised, and rewarded by God. But it depends on how you lead many to righteousness. These are the rewards. Your light depends on how many you lead to righteousness. So maybe your light might be like a firefly. Sometimes there is, sometimes no, or like ember, very, very dim, or like your cell phone, one watt LED, or some might be like a headlight, or some might be like, wow, laser light, very, very bright, or some will be like the sun. So it depends on how wise you are while you are in this earth, before rapture or before going into the millennium. Okay, so how can we be wise in God's eyes? Number one, by being righteous and doing what is right. That's what Daniel do. Daniel is wise in the eyes of God. The word of God says, now Daniel so distinguished himself by his exceptional qualities that the king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. I believe the word exceptional qualities does not talk about his managerial skill, governing skill, or administrative skill. No. The exceptional qualities is because of his spiritual qualities. Daniel, he feared God. He worshiped God. He loved God. And he obeyed God's word, even among the pagans. He was also intimate with God. He loves to pray to God and intercede for the people. That's Daniel's exceptional qualities that the king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. Because I believe that the other satraps, the other people, the other administrators, they also have many of those managerial, administrative quality. But Daniel is different from them. And not only that, not only Daniel loved God, served God, worshiped the true God, intimate with the true God, he was also not corrupt, not negligent. He has good character. So the word of God says, at these administrators and the satraps tried to find grounds for charges against Daniel in his conduct of government affairs, but they were unable to do so. They could find no corruption in him because he was trustworthy, neither corrupt nor negligent. Daniel was trustworthy. So I hope that all of us in our ministry, in our work, we are wise, we are being righteous, we do what is right, we are trustworthy. We will not be corrupt, we will not be negligent. So we can see the good testimony of Daniel. And also Daniel obeyed God's word, obeyed God's command and requirements. So in Micah chapter 6, verse 8, the word of God says, he has shown you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? What does the Lord require of us? To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. So that's what Daniel, he really do the requirements of God. That's what God wants him in a pagan nation to do this. We can see Daniel, from his youth up to now, he's old already. If you look at not only at Daniel, but you look also at Jeremiah, 2 Kings, and some secular history, Daniel passed through at least 7 kings and some dynasties. And how can Daniel pass through 7 kings and a few dynasties from Babylon to the Medo-Persian Empire. It because of his exceptional qualities. Because Daniel, he feared God, loved God, worshiped God. He has good character. He has good testimony. He's intimate with God. May we also be like that. So we can see that Daniel, oh, he not only is being righteous, and not only that he do what is right. The second thing is that he remains faithful in spite of adversity. Being wise in God's eyes by remaining faithful in spite of adversity. Even at the expense of being thrown into the lion's den. But Daniel insists to pray to the true God and was not afraid of the king's edict of being thrown to the lion's den. How about you? Are you afraid of being thrown to the lion's den? Don't talk about throwing to the lion's den. Maybe the dog barking, we're already afraid, right? Or even maybe rats, we are afraid of rats. And maybe even hippies or cockroaches, we'll be afraid. What more, lion? But Daniel is not afraid. When I was young, I see how the cat catch rats and how they box the rat and how they chew slowly from the extremities until the head is left and the mouth still moving. So it's really fearful to be eaten by lion. I even see video of a lion eating a man because the man came out of the car in the safari and the lion. So it's faithful. But Daniel, he's not afraid. He remained faithful in spite of different adversities. So because Daniel remained faithful, he was thrown into the lion's den. I want to ask you, how old was Daniel when he was thrown into the lion's den? What do you think? 60 years old? 70? Or 80? Daniel and his friends and the people in Judah, they're brought into captivity to Babylon in the year 605 BC. During that time, Daniel was about 16 to 18 years old. And this time, in the time of King Darius, it was already 539 BC. More than 66 years have passed. So if Daniel was 16 years old during that time, he's now 82 years old. But you can see Daniel, 82 years old, from the lion's den, the mouth thrown down, he was not sprained. Why? I believe two things. First, his body is really very fit. He exercised every day. So I challenge all of you, even me. I have exercised every day. I have to remain fit, strong. Because if you're not fit, no need the lion to bite you or do things. You just throw you down, then you're dead already. But no. Second, God protected him. Because the Bible says, no bruise, no harm, no scratch was on Daniel. Daniel slept the whole night. Wow, with the lion beside him. Wow, with the pillow of the lion's hair. Wow, so good. Because Daniel remained faithful. And that also happens before, in the time of Nebuchadnezzar, for Daniel's three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. King Nebuchadnezzar asked all the people to worship his golden statue. But Daniel's friends, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, will not comply. So they are being thrown to the burning furnace. But before being thrown, the king gave them a chance to pray and to worship the golden image. But what did the three friends do? They said, O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the burning furnace, the God we serve is able to save us from it, and he will rescue us from your hand, O king. But even if he does not, we want you to know, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold you have set up. So, it's very important that in spite of adversities, we will remain faithful to the Lord. There are two things which cause us to backslide or to renounce our faith or to freak out. First, adversities, persecution, difficulties. Second, prosperity. So frustrating that people will forget God. People will have no time for God already. So even in these two, adversity, prosperity, we should remain faithful in the Lord. So brothers and sisters, especially we, full-timers, we are the model examples of those people who loves God, who follows God, who are in the church. How are we? Do we remain faithful in spite of the problems, in spite of the things that has happened, prosperity or adversity? May the Lord strengthen us. Third, and the last, how can we be wise in God's eyes? By leading people to righteousness and the true God. That's why, again, in Daniel chapter 12, verse 3, the word of God says, those people who are wise, wise in the eyes of God and the world, they will shine like the brightness of the heavens. How bright you are depends on how you lead many to righteousness. And those people who lead many to righteousness will be like the stars forever and ever. I believe the king was led by Daniel to righteousness even before the lion's den incident. How do we know that? We know that because the king showed his love to Daniel by wanting to rescue Daniel from the lion's den. Oh, so the king really see the exceptional spiritual qualities of Daniel. He's above other people. And the king see his godliness. So the king loved him. Oh, look at here in Daniel 6:14. The word of God says, when the king heard this, he was greatly distressed. If the king don't love you, the king don't respect you, why will he be greatly distressed? And then the king was determined to rescue Daniel and made every effort until sundown to save him. So even before the incident or the miracle of God saving Daniel from the lions, then the king already see the godliness of Daniel. And then after Daniel was thrown to the lions, then in verse 18 says, then the king returned to his palace and spent the night without eating, fasya, and without entertainment, without the dancing, without the music. Oh, and he could not sleep. That's how the king loved Daniel. So after the miracle, after that, when the morning came, the king saw that Daniel, he was saved from the mouth of the lions. So what did the king do? The king really praised the true God of the heaven, the creators of the heaven and the sovereign God. So the king made an edict. And what did the king say? The king say, I issue a decree that in every part of my kingdom, people must fear reverence the God of Daniel. You see, a pagan king will say that you worship and fear the God of Daniel, for he is the living God and he endures forever. His kingdom will not be destroyed. His dominion will never end. And he rescues and he saves. He performs signs and wonders in the heavens and on the earth. He has rescued Daniel from the power of lions. During that time, the lions are the most powerful animals. People fear the lions. and Daniel was saved. Not a scratch, not a bruise. So Daniel prospered. But when Daniel's instigator, accusers, was thrown into the lions, then what does the Bible say? Even in half air, all of those lions jump and bite them and kill all of them, even the family member, because they connive with them. The Lord prospered Daniel because Daniel leads the king and the people to righteousness, to through God. So who is the source of righteousness? Jesus Christ. If you look at the New Testament and even the Old Testament, you can see that Jesus Christ, he is the King of righteousness and he is the source of righteousness. So if we are wise, we should lead people to righteousness. That's why Chinese word E, righteousness, is written like this. The lamb, and the word below, wo, is me. To be righteous, the Lamb of God, which takes away the sins of the world, should be above us. We should be under him. We should receive him as Lord and Savior so that we'll become righteous. The righteousness of Christ will be upon us. So it's very important that we, as Christians, as BSOPians, or as full-timers, as pastors, as leaders of the church, should really bring people to righteousness. Oh, Jesus is the Savior of the world. Christmas time is the best time, but it passed already. New Year is also the best time. Every day is the best time. We should really bring people to righteousness. If you want to be bright during the resurrection, if you want to be rewarded, yes, salvation is free, but the crowns, the rewards, your life depends on how you lead people to Christ. I want to encourage all of you, even in the BSOP Viber group or other, I always post how God encourage me, use me to share the gospel to people. It's not bragging, but just to encourage that all of us, we should do that. We should really share and be a model and lead people to righteousness. So I praise God for the many opportunity to share Christ. When I went to the States last year in May with my son, I see to it that my relatives, whom I have met for more than 45 years, like this one, 45 years, did not meet. And I shared the gospel to him, and he received the Lord. And this is my tutor. For 50 years, we have not met. I found him in Google and connected with him, and praise the Lord. We met in Canada. I shared the gospel to him. And his brother, also assistant tutor of mine, when I'm grade 2, they both received the Lord, the family. Oh, and this is my uncle and auntie, father's side auntie, the youngest sister of my third. Also, 45 years not meeting, then we met them in Nevada, Reno, Nevada. These two sisters, we shared the gospel to them. They received the Lord. And when we are having tour, these are the tour guide, United States tour guide. This is a Canadian tour guide. This is the United States tour guide. Share the gospel to them. And this is the Indian. Share the gospel to them. The Irishman, he's a former Catholic, but in 80s, share the gospel. But he didn't receive the Lord. He don't want. But still, you have to share the gospel. Even sick people, old people, businessmen. This is a businessman from Davao. Her daughter is a pilot in PAL. She's a CCFers, but her father didn't receive the Lord. So I shared the gospel. He received the Lord. And these are words in our ancestral home. Share the gospel to them. So it's all opportunity. Let's find time. This in our condominium. This is the engineer. This is a plumber, electrician, office staff. Share the gospel. And we have four Bible study group in our condo. These are the housekeepers, housekeeping, the janitors, the janitress, share the gospel. They all receive the Lord. And we're having Bible study. Tomorrow we will have Bible study. The guards, all the guards are sharing the gospel. Even Muslims, these are Muslim guards, share the gospel. They believe they receive the Lord. And in CCF Welcome Center, share the gospel. Young and old, this is my son. Okay, share the gospel. These are LGBTQ people. I share the gospel to them. And from mainland China, they came to the Philippines. This is an educator who has a school in La Salle and other place teaching Chinese. He came. He's a communist poor. He came to know the Lord. He received the Lord. And this is a businessman, young businessman from China. He came to the Philippines. He's the one who made an application, a Bible app called One Bible. But he's not a Christian, but he called Bible because he said that it's good to do this. And then I shared the gospel. He received the Lord. Even going to Thailand last year, shared the gospel to Thailander, received the Lord. Traveling to Bacolod, in the airport, shared the gospel to the engineer, he received the Lord. And this one from the United States coming back, shared the gospel to this person, he received the Lord. And just yesterday, last night, he's a bodyguard of the Pogo people, but he resigned and he became a grab driver. And I shared the gospel, he received the Lord. And he said it's really true that the kidnapping is really rampant last year. And really, there are many who are killed. It's really, and many kidnapped. So it's really disheartening to these things. So. And even in wedding parties, share the gospel to this young businessman. And even in birthday parties, share the gospel. This is Alex, also alumni. His two aunties, last year, December, share the gospel. And before going to Hong Kong, I shared the gospel to this Grab driver. And in Hong Kong, share the gospel to this bank officer. In the coffee shop. So just share, just lead people to Rajas. In Taiwan, rich or poor, young or old, just share the gospel to them. Okay, these are squatter people in Taiwan. Share, these are big businessmen. Share the gospel. This is my hair grooming in the parlor, share the gospel to her. She received the Lord. And this engineer from China Airline, share the gospel to him. The wife is already a Christian, but the husband's not yet. So share, receive the Lord. These are also from squatter. And this is a professor, share the gospel to him. So we just let God work in our life. We lead people to righteousness. And the whole family, this one in China, in Taiwan, last year, March 29, the patriarchs are being baptized. The whole family came to know the Lord, even the two kids, and they're being baptized. And they throw away all the idols they have at home, except this big one, costs about 5 million pesos or more, made of rare hinoki wood. So they did not throw it, but they donated it to the museum, not to be worshipped, but to be put in the museum only. But the others, we already burn and throw out all, everything already. So really, the Lord is working, and we just have to really let God work. Lastly, maybe you will say, Pastor, you are really very good. You're good in sharing the gospel. Or you say, I'm not like Daniel. Who has a position. But remember, Daniel's asleep when he was in Israel, but he shined for the Lord. He did not let his circumstances made him to be in fear, but he obeyed God. You should not say that I'm more than ordinary. God uses ordinary people. So I'm going to introduce to you this person. This is Mr. Wong. More than 15 years ago, he was diagnosed with terminal cancer. And the doctor said that he has only a few months to live. And this is Violi, Sister Violi, a domestic helper in the household of Mr. and Mrs. Wong. So when Sister Violi learned that Mr. Wong has a terminal cancer, Sister Violi told Mrs. Wong, Can I pray for Mr. Wong? If you're Mrs. Wong, will you allow a domestic helper to pray for your husband? But Mrs. Wong allowed, because Mrs. Wong said, I don't lose anything, just let her pray. But when Sister Violi prayed for Mr. Wong, miracle happened, breakthrough happened. Slowly, Mr. Wong was revived. He did not die. And Mr. Wong, because of gratitude, and Mrs. Wong, they praise the Lord. Because this Mr. Wong is a big-time architect. In his architectural firm, he has 80 workers in the office alone, and not counting all the other workers in the construction work. He's a big time. So the Lord blessed them. So because God blessed Mr. and Mrs. Wong, so Mr. and Mrs. Wong, because of gratitude, he built a church for the church of Sister Violi near to Gegarao City. It's an outskirt of Gegarao City with this big church. That cost, during that time, 23 million pesos. And not only the church, beside is a house. And whose house is that? Some will say it's the house of Sister Violi. No, it's the house, the patronage, the house for the pastors and his family and the wife. Because it's the pastor who trained and teach Violi to share the gospel to pray for other people. So the pastors benefited. This is a night view of the church. Very beautiful. Not only Mr. and Mrs. Wong donated for the church building, Mr. and Mrs. Wong also donated a church van, a jeep type to the church so that they can bring more people to the church and bring people to the Lord. Not only that, Mr. and Mrs. Wong also built a house. And whose house is this? Maybe you say it's for Sister Violi. No. Sister Violi remained a domestic helper, sex help, and this for her family, the father, mother, the siblings of Sister Violi. Oh, you see how, because of Sister Violi, a domestic helper, bringing Mr. and Mrs. Wong to the Lord, and the Lord works through them. And Mr. and Mrs. Wong also helped finance for the training center in Nepal, and also help finance to build the church in Kiev. I believe the church is still there. Putin did not send a missile to this place. So. And not only in Kiev, Mr. Mrs. Wong also built a church in Cambodia. And not only that, also built a church in Chongqing, China. So really because of just an ordinary domestic helper who choose to be courageous and ask for prayer for Mr. Wong, and the Lord works miracle, and this happened. So my challenge for you this morning and noontime, be wise in the eyes of God. Because of time, I want to share with you a song to end. And may the Lord speak to us through this song. This song, up to now, every time I hear, the Lord is touching me. And this song was written and sung by Keith Green. Shall we listen to this song?
See all the people sinking down. Don't you care? Don't you care? Are you gonna let them drown? How can you be so numb not to care if they come? You close your eyes and pretend the job's done. Oh, bless me, Lord. Bless me, Lord. You know, it's all I ever hear. No one aches, no one hurts, no one even sheds one tear. But he cries, he weeps, he bleeds, and he cares for your needs. and you just lay back and keep soaking it in. Came to your door, you've left him out on the streets. Open up, and give yourself away. You see the need, you hear the cries, so how can you delay? God's calling, and you're the one. Like Johnny, you run. He's told you to speak, but you keep holding it in. Oh, can't you see such sin? The world is sleeping in the dark that the church just can't fight, 'cause it's asleep in the light. How can you be so dead when you've been so well? Jesus rose from the grave, and you can't even get out of bed. Oh, Jesus rose from the dead. Job's done. You close your eyes and pretend the job's done. Don't close your eyes, don't pretend the job's done. Come away, with me, my love. Oh, come away from this mess, come away with me, my love.
Before our, before I give a closing prayer, let's open our video again. I want to see all of you. Please open your video, then let's pray. Huh? Just click it. After praying, I want to see all of you. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you very much for your message and challenge to each one of us. Lord, we want to be wise in your eyes. We want to be like Daniel. Lord, we want to be righteous and do what is right. We want to remain faithful in you in spite of adversity or even prosperity, Lord. And Lord, we want to lead people to the true God, to Jesus Christ, to salvation, to eternal life. So Lord, help us, Lord, not to be asleep in the light. We are in the light already, but we don't want to be sleeping, but we should be sharing the light. We should be sharing Jesus to other people, Lord. May, Lord, your message be an encouragement to each one of us to really go out, Lord, to be a model, to really bring people the lost and to move other Christians to do likewise, to share your righteousness, to lead people to righteousness, Lord. So that, Lord, when you come again, Lord, and during the resurrection of the righteous, Lord, we will shine like the stars. We will shine brightly, Lord, because we obeyed you. We love you. We are humble in your sight. Thank you. Bless us, Lord. Bless our family. Keep us healthy, Lord, safe and strong to minister, to fulfill the great commission and the great commandment. Thank you. This we pray in the wonderful name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And everyone say, amen and amen. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Amen.